In this lesson, we will work through an example of analyzing flow through pipes that are in a parallel configuration. Here we have a system where water is flowing through three circular pipes that are set up in parallel. The flow enters at point A, and then the flow is split into pipes 1, 2, and 3, and finally the flow exits at point B. We are given some information about this system of pipes. Pipe 1 is the middle path. It has a diameter d of 8 centimeters, an absolute roughness epsilon of 0.24 millimeters, and a length L of 100 meters. Pipe 2 is the longest path. It has a diameter of 6 centimeters, an absolute roughness of 0.12 millimeters, and a length of 150 meters. Pipe 3 is the shortest path. It has a diameter of 4 centimeters, an absolute roughness of 0.20 millimeters, and a length of 80 meters. Note that this system of pipes is not drawn to scale. We are viewing the pipe network from above, and the difference in elevation between points A and B is negligible. Pressure gauges located at inlet A and inlet B indicate the pressure difference between those two points is 200 kilopascals. The diameter of the pipes at inlet A and outlet B are the same, and a thermometer indicates that the water temperature is 15 degrees Celsius throughout the system. To simplify this problem, we will neglect minor losses and only consider the major losses. That is, we will only consider the losses due to friction in straight runs of pipe. This is a reasonable assumption in many situations where there are very long runs of pipe. Based on the given information, we want to calculate the total volumetric flow rate flowing through the system, QAB. QAB is found in the conservation of mass equation, which for a parallel pipe system is QAB equals Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3. The volumetric flow rate through each pipe is the flow speed V times the cross-sectional area pi over 4 times d squared. So QAB is equal to V1 times pi over 4 d1 squared plus V2 times pi over 4 d2 squared plus V3 times pi over 4 d3 squared. At this point, we know the diameters, but not the speeds. So we will need to use conservation of energy to help us find V1, V2, and V3. We will apply the conservation of energy equation for each pipe individually. First, we draw a control volume for the flow that goes through pipe 1. The inlet is at point A and the outlet is at point B. The conservation of energy equation for this control volume is the pressure head plus velocity head plus elevation head at outlet B is equal to the pressure head plus velocity head plus elevation head at inlet A minus the head loss through pipe 1 plus the pump head minus the turbine head. Since we have steady flow, and the pipe diameter at A and B are the same, the velocity at A and B are the same as well, and the velocity head terms cancel out. It was given that the inlet and outlet elevations are the same, so ZA and ZB cancel out as well. The pump head and turbine head are zero, since no pumps or turbines exist in the control volume. Rearranging the terms that survive, we find that the head loss through pipe 1, HL1, is equal to the pressure difference, PA minus PB, divided by the specific weight of water, gamma. The pressure difference is 200,000 pascals, and the specific weight of water at 15 degrees Celsius is approximately 9,800 newtons per cubic meter. This gives us a head loss of 20.4 meters. In an earlier video, we found that the head loss for parallel pipes that have the same beginning and end conditions is the same, so the head loss through pipe 2 and pipe 3 also is 20.4 meters. Since the same equation applies to all three pipes, we will temporarily replace the subscript 1 in the energy equation with a subscript I, where I can be 1, 2, or 3. The major loss through pipe I is calculated from the Darcy-Weisbach equation, which is the friction factor Fi, times pipe length Li over pipe diameter Di, times speed Vi squared, divided by 2 times the gravitational acceleration G. If the flow is turbulent, the friction factor can be calculated from the Halland equation and is a function of the absolute roughness epsilon I, pipe diameter Di, and Reynolds number REI. The Reynolds number for pipe I is fluid density rho times flow speed Vi times pipe diameter Di divided by the absolute viscosity mu. There is no subscript I for density and viscosity because we assume those two quantities are constant throughout the flow. As mentioned earlier, the Halland equation should only be used for turbulent flows. This occurs when the Reynolds number is greater than 4,000. At this point in the problem, we don't know the flow speed, so we don't know whether the Halland equation is valid. However, fluids like water and air usually experience turbulent flow conditions, so it's reasonable to start with an assumption of turbulent flow. After we obtain the value for the flow speed and can calculate the Reynolds number, we will check whether the turbulent flow assumption was valid. We substitute the Darcy-Weisbach and Halland equations into the energy equation and examine pipe 1. Note that the subscript I has been replaced by the number 1. The diameter, absolute roughness, and length of pipe 1 were already given. At 15 degrees Celsius, the density of water is 999 kilograms per cubic meter, and the absolute viscosity is 1.14 times 10 to the minus 3 newton seconds per meter squared. And the gravitational acceleration is 9.81 meters per second squared. This means the only unknown quantity in the equation is the speed V1. Unfortunately, it's too difficult to solve this equation for V1 through algebraic manipulation. So we have three options. Notice that the right side of the equation is zero. This means we only need to find a value of V1 that will make the left side of the equation zero as well. The first option for solving this equation involves us guessing a value of V1 and then refining that guess until the left side of the equation is close enough to zero that we're satisfied. The second option is to use a numerical method to solve for V1 in a more systematic manner than just guessing. Common numerical methods that solve nonlinear algebraic equations, like the energy equation shown here, are the bisection method, Newton-Raphson method, and secant method. The third option is to use software that utilizes a numerical method to solve nonlinear algebraic equations. For example, if you have access to MATLAB, there's a built-in function called F0 that is fairly easy to use. Here's an example of how to find V1 using the first option. Let's start by guessing 10 meters per second for V1. Plugging that value into the left side of the equation gives -147.7, which is not close to zero. So the actual value of V1 is probably not close to 10 meters per second. If we now try guessing 2 meters per second for V1, the left side of the equation becomes smaller and positive, 13.50. Since the sign has changed from negative to positive, the value of V1 is between 2 meters per second and 10 meters per second. So let's try 5 meters per second. The left side of the equation becomes negative 21.91. Since the sign has changed back to negative, we have overshot the actual value of V1. So let's try a speed between 2 meters per second and 5 meters per second, like 3.5 meters per second. Now the left side of the equation has become much smaller in magnitude, negative 0.4456. This means V1 likely is pretty close to 3.5 meters per second. We continue this process until V1 is equal to 3.462, which makes the left side of the equation equal to 5.719 times 10 to the minus 4. We could continue to refine our estimate of V1, but since we likely don't know the values of the other variables like pipe diameter and roughness to a high level of accuracy, and the Halland equation already has significant error built into it, finding V1 to 4 digits of accuracy is more than enough. At this point, we should calculate the Reynolds number to verify the turbulent assumption was valid. If the Reynolds number is above 4,000, our value of V1 is good. If the Reynolds number was below 4,000, you can try using the head loss expression for laminar flows, which was presented in a prior video. On your own, you can verify the Reynolds number is close to 240,000, which means we have found a valid value of V1. Now that we have found a value for V1, we can calculate Q1. This process can be repeated to find V2 and V3 by replacing all the 1 subscripts with either 2 or 3. Now we're going to talk about a way to solve this problem quickly using the third option that was mentioned earlier. We will use the F0 function in MATLAB. One of the great advantages of using MATLAB or any other software package over the trial and error method that was just performed is that once you input the commands into MATLAB, it takes MATLAB almost no time at all to calculate the speed. At the command line in MATLAB, which is indicated by the double greater than symbols, we assign values for the known quantities of density, absolute viscosity, gravitational acceleration, length, diameter, and absolute roughness, making sure that all the lengths are in meters. Next, we can create an anonymous function in the following manner. We need a name for the function, which is called the function handle, and I'm going to name this function energy, since it is the energy equation. The function energy equals at V, and then the expression for the energy equation is written. MATLAB will treat V as the quantity to be solved for, and it'll treat all other variables like density, viscosity, and so on as constants whose values are defined earlier in the code. The 3 dots in the middle of the equation simply indicate to MATLAB that the equation continues on to the next line. Now we can use the F0 function by writing V1 equals F0, begin parentheses, energy, comma 10, end parentheses. The first argument in F0 is the function handle energy, and the second argument in the function, the number 10, is our initial guess for the solution for the speed. Now it's okay to be wrong about the initial guess. MATLAB just needs an initial value to start its numerical method. When F0 is finished, it will store the resulting value in the variable V1. So after hitting the enter key, F0 quickly returns 3.4620 and assigns this value to V1. This is the value for V1 that will make the energy equation approximately 0. Now we must confirm that the Reynolds number in the pipe is greater than 4,000. We multiply density, V1, diameter, and divide by viscosity, and we get that the Reynolds number, RE1, is 242,000. So our use of the Halland equation was okay. Now we can calculate the volumetric flow rate through pipe 1 by multiplying V1 with the cross-sectional area pi over 4 times d squared. The volumetric flow rate through pipe 1, Q1, is 0.01740 cubic meters per second. If we repeat this procedure with the length, diameter, and absolute roughness of pipe 2 and pipe 3, we find that Q2 is 0.007211 cubic meters per second, and Q3 is 0.003173 cubic meters per second. Adding Q1, Q2, and Q3, we find that the total volumetric flow rate is 0.0278 cubic meters per second.